to God here in glory. Thank
you.
Because the Lord is
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes. 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 Hallelujah. Yes. Yes. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Hallelujah.
Yes. 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 Squeezing that hand, let's just go ahead and for the next few seconds begin to lift to the Lord. Person whose hand you're holding, that way, lift them in prayer just for a moment. Open your mouth and let them hear your prayer for the Lord. Shalom and glory of his disciples, we know we have an answer now. Let pray about this to pass upon us. Bless the person whose hand I'm holding. Bless. Ask the Lord to bless them and to feed them and to receive. Is not dead. God is calling for those who are willing to die.
Amen.
For what they believe in.
Thank you.
And to stand for what they know is right. Such a ship you have embarked upon as the World Harvest Kingdom Church rolls on. This is one of these ships that are a part of the ship of Zion.
Yes,
and as God would prepare you to go into deep waters, he wants you not only to understand the worthship of the pastor that you have, but to share the worthship of every single member that is a part of this family of God.
Yes.
To know and to understand that there are no little lies and no big eyes and no little U's is certainly something that God gives us to share as part of his royal priesthood, his holy nation. Go ahead and look at somebody and tell them, I'm royal just like you.
I'm royal just like you.
I am God's finest just like you. I am God's elite just like you. I am God's ambassador just like you. So that tonight, God wants to stir our hearts to know that we can indeed go into deep waters.
Yes.
Psalm 107 begins with the words of the psalmist that is speaking out of the experience or to the experience of a people that God has brought back from captivity because they did not show the worship of him who deserves all the glory. And coming back from 70 years of captivity, where God promised that these are just years to give you an opportunity to think about what I've done for you that you have not been grateful for. God puts them on time out so that they can, by the rivers of Babylon, bring up their hearts and meditate on the fact that God is the God who brought them out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, brought them through the wilderness of sin, brought them into the promised land, drove out their enemies, gave them the land for possession, in spite of the fact that they did not tell the children how God had brought them through. He still allowed the children to grow up even though they did not know the Lord. He brought them through what they had to go through using leadership that brought them out of their derision. And after that, he embraced them again and gave them a king, the king they asked for. And when that king didn't work, he gave them a man after his own heart.
Amen.
And that man, along with God, began to raise them up and to give them an understanding that worship means everything to God.
Come on now.
No matter what you have, no matter what you own, no matter what you
don't
have, if you will give him glory for what you
do, thank you, Lord.
And show the worship
thank you, Lord.
He has given you. It doesn't mind if you show the worship of the house that he gave you because he gave it to you. And so you're not in God's disfavor if you show the worship or worship to your house. It comes from that English word, worship, which means to show the value of a thing. And so he says, I gave it to you. Keep it clean. get the rats and roaches out of there, they don't fit in. And get it into the order that it should be in. Pick up the clothes and wipe and wash the dishes and make sure that the shutters are clean and make sure that it's painted. Make sure that it's taken care of because I gave it to you.
Amen.
So you show the worthship of it, and he says at the same time, I don't mind. You show the worthship of the car I gave you, the brand new car I gave you. Driving around and letting people see how good I've been to you. But at the same time,
I
will not take care of
you.
Every oil change, every tires rotate. Doesn't matter whether it's a Hootie or a Lexus. Make sure that God knows that you care and you appreciate what he has given to you. And this attitude of gratitude does not stop at the materialistic things that God affords us. As stewards, he wants us to be thankful for the people that he sends into our lives. So God does not mind you showing the worship of that husband he gave you. Make sure he knows he has an S on his chest. Make sure he understands that he's the king of the roost. Make sure that he knows that he's your superman. You can indeed do that, even if he wants to watch the football game on Sunday. Then to take him his favorite meal. Sit on his lap and tell him, I'm your halftime show. I know he's a brand that you adore. Let him know that he's the one that actually makes you get up and cook the biscuits and wash the clothes. And I have a show that you don't mind because that's what God has given you. Show the worship of that wife I gave you. Not that same-sex partner, not that chick on the side, not Robbie's wife, the wife I gave you, your bone and your flesh. I don't mind you showing her worship. Give her what she needs. Buy her rose. Call her from work. Open the door. Open it. Let her know that she is the apple of your eye. When she passes by, hit her on the backside and tell her, hey, you still got it. I still got it. God says, I don't mind you showing the worship of that little boy, that little girl I gave you, your pokey food, because you stood on the brink of death to bring that child into the world. Your bones moved so that that child could come forth. I don't mind you buying DS2. I don't mind you buying the Nike tennis shoes. I don't mind you showing the worship of anything or anybody as long as you don't put anything or anybody in front of me. First, you'll have no problem with me, and there's no good thing I will withhold from you. Israel and Judah had a problem with that, and because they did, they ended up in captivity. Not because they ran around with other women or other men, but because they refused to give God everything that he deserved. As a result, he gave Jeremiah a word that's found in the 29th chapter. And Jeremiah says, while you are on this sabbatical from God, while you are separated from him because you did not give him the glory that was due his name, you gave him half-hearted worship, pity-pat worship, the kind of worship that says you better be glad up here. And God says, I don't want that. I want you to give me the kind of worship that says you're glad that you are here. And at the same time, God was correcting them and chastening them because that's what a good father does. He gave them hope to know that it won't be this long. It won't be any longer than it takes for you to come to yourself and put me first. And when you put me first, then I'm going to return to you. So he told Jeremiah, Jerry, I want you to tell them from me, while they are in this low ground of captivity, while they are amongst the people that are ungrateful. Look at somebody and tell them she's not talking about me.
Oh, no,
talking about me.
There are those who are among us. us who do not honor, who do not understand that it was God on our side who brought us this far. It was not because we were rich, it wasn't because we were smart, it was because we were the best ones or even the most qualified. But the Lord Himself has watched out for us. The Lord Himself has taken care of us. The Lord Himself has provided for us. Well, the psalmist will tell you this way. If you really understand that it was the Lord that kept you, that gathered you, that brought you in from where you were wandering, and brought you to a place now where you understand that you are where you're supposed to be, and God has given you an opportunity to worship Him in the beauty of holiness, then He says you're for a praise right now. Let's Him understand that you are grateful, so very grateful, for what He has already done. And then the psalmist says, he says, listen, if you are really understanding this gratitude that Jeremiah is after and that God will not literally do without, then you understand that while God is still working, while He is still developing you, while He is still correcting you, in the midst of whatever you're doing that you're not supposed to be doing, and indeed, we do things that we're not supposed to do. We do leave things undone that we were supposed to do. And God says, while you are in this mode of operation, I want you to understand that I have not given up on you. I have not rewarded you according to what you have done or have left undone. But I have had mercy on you. Even in the midst of a rebellious moment, look at somebody and tell them, I do have my moments when I come short of His glory. But I don't do what He has told me to do. But I leave something off that I was supposed to do. Go ahead and look at your neighbor and tell them, don't let me be funny. You're just the same in the same boat. And yet God has been good to us and has rewarded us according to our deeds or our misdeeds.
That's right.
Whether it's 16 years, whether it's 2 years and 8 months, God has given to us and extended to us every morning new mercies. I used up all my mercies yesterday. But early this morning, God met me with a whole batch of new mercies. And if that's you, the psalmist says, you just ought to put a praise for it. Because God is in the midst of growing you and preparing you to take you to another level. And the praise that was concerning yesterday, God says, I'm going to grow it up. Because yesterday's praise has to be matched with today's. But what He did yesterday is gone. Yesterday is history. And tomorrow is a mystery. The only thing you have is right now. So God says, no matter what yesterday held, and no matter what I kept you from last week, today is the day that I have made for you to rejoice and be glad in. Would you let somebody tell me He's still worthy for a praise today? Says you're embarking on year number 17. And you can't just say thank you for yesterday, thank you for all you've done for me, but Lord, I just want to thank you for what you're doing for me right now. The Lord is blessing you right now. Then praise those right now. And you can't wait until they get home if you're feeling better right now. You can't wait until tomorrow or Sunday morning if He has He's my healer. He's my Lord. Let somebody join in the preacher. teachings that are going with him.
Yes.
They are with him.
Yeah.
He teaches them.
Yes.
And on this particular day,
yes.
He teaches them.
Yes.
Just like tomorrow. On this particular day, he teaches them.
Yes.
And wanting to know if they're paying attention.
That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right.
Wanting to know if they're getting it. Yeah. Coming to church, they ain't getting it.
That's right. Tell them.
Serving on the board, they ain't getting
it. Come on.
Being on the choir, serving on the board.
Come on.
That ain't getting it.
Amen.
Getting it is when you walk out the word.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
When you let it be seen.
Yes.
What you have heard.
Yes.
And he teaches them about faith all day, faith all day, faith all day. At the end of the day, he tells them, let's go to the other side. We're going to the other side.
Amen.
And they get in the ship. And the storm comes.
Yes. Yes.
And he calls for it. Because it's a pop quiz.
Yeah.
Become torrential and the rain is coming from the side, from the top, and from around them. And Peter, who is a master shipman, can't even turn the ship. They're looking at him. And all the rest of the disciples are looking at each other. And the water is coming into the ship. And now everybody is looking at each other saying, why don't you do something? Thomas is yelling all out of me, well, why don't you do something? And Bartholomew is saying, well, why don't you stop down and do something? And John is telling Peter, why don't you stop? Everybody just a man. wrong. Now we mess up. We prayed, didn't we? And he said, yeah, you prayed, and there's nothing wrong with prayer. But I'm not leaving you there. 16 years you've been praying. I've been answering prayer.
Yes.
But going into deep waters, it's going to require another method. He said, listen, you prayed because that's what you used to. But that wasn't a test. The test wasn't to know whether or not you prayed, whether you trusted me. I'm here with you. You know I can handle the storm. But the test was to find out whether you were paying attention to the cheat sheet that I gave you before we got on the boat. And that was this. Boys, we're going to the other side. Now, when I told you that, that was a truth that should have enveloped you. So that when the storm developed around you, the truth in you would have stood up.
Stood up.
And instead of looking at the storm and asking me to quiet the storm, you should have taken your rightful place, not just as a priest.
Jesus.
I called you to be a priest.
Yes.
I worked with you as a priest. You have operated as a priest. But going into the next dimension, I'm going to need you to step it up and become a king. Because kings and priests is what I'm calling you to be. Priests pray, but kings decree. And kings command.